focused on the high road of equity, sustainability, and democracy. And we work with cities all over the country to help them learn about policies and programs and bring good ideas to their places. Today we're going to be talking about ways in which particularly cities can leverage procurement, the money that they spend for the new economy, for good jobs, for communities, for the priorities that we hold as communities. And so this is a sort of local government or state or federal government, but it's a lot easier to work at the local level, in my opinion, strategy. But it's also a strategy that's really relevant, I think, for anybody who's working in community in a city, because there is a lot of money being spent. And there's no reason that some of that money can't be leveraged to support the work you're doing, to support your communities, to support people, to support them getting good jobs. And so we're going to hear about some strategies, some policies, some places that that's working, and hopefully you can learn from that and take it back to your places. We do have more resources on this topic up on our website at mayorsinnovation.org, and both of the speakers have resources as well that they'll be telling you about. I do want to say first, though, that Chanel Smith, who works for the Cuyahoga County Department of Sustainability and runs a really fabulous program and has been instrumental in setting it up even before she was at the county, around energy efficiency in municipal and government buildings and job creation. And unfortunately, she's not here with us today. Her car got broken into this morning as she was setting off to drive up from Cleveland, and now it's not working, and there's all sorts of things to deal with. So she's very sorry that she can't be here. But if you get a chance, you should look at what both Emerald Cities, Cleveland, and Cuyahoga County, the Office of Sustainability, the work that they're doing, because it's some pretty fabulous stuff. I'm going to introduce the two speakers that we do have with us, and then they're going to talk for a little while, and then we'll should have plenty of time for questions and discussion at the end, if folks have them. We're going to start with Mariah Montgomery with the Partnership for Working Families. She leads the partnership's strategic initiatives to propel the future of work towards worker power and equity, with a focus on non-standard fissured employment and the way technology is changing work and organizing. Before the partnership, she was the Deputy Campaign Director for Retail Initiatives at the Change to Win Labor Federation, where she led innovative campaigns in retail and telecommunications with an emphasis on corporate strategy, regulation, and public policy. And following Mariah is Jessie Kingston from the city of St. Paul, Minnesota. She's the director of St. Paul's Department of Human Rights and Equal Economic Opportunity. And she's got a lot going on right now. So it's really remarkable that she took the time out of some very serious stuff happening in her city to come and be with us and talk about this. So we really appreciate that, Jessie. She's formerly was the Associate Director of Purchasing for Digital River and has close to 20 years of experience working at various levels of leadership in the private sector. As a member of the IDINA Human Rights Commission since 2009 and chair for the past 2 years, she has been in front of a range of municipal and statewide human and civil rights issues. And one thing that I hope you'll say a little bit about is the connection between your work in economic opportunity and human rights. And to me, it's interesting and unusual that St. Paul has decided to do it that way. So without further ado, we will manage technology and get, no, go away. And get Mariah up here. All you. And I'm gonna go watch from over here. Okay.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Satya, for organizing this panel and for all of you for coming. Today, I'm going to start by telling you a little bit about the Partnership for Working Families, click through some of the tools that our network uses to leverage procurement to build equity in cities, and then spend the bulk of my time focusing on two case studies that I hope will be demonstrative. So the Partnership for Working Families works to make sure that our communities have a voice so that everyone has access to work with dignity and healthy, sustainable communities for themselves and for their loved ones. We have 17 city affiliates that bring grassroots voices to the forefront of workplace, community, and ballot box to build worker power and to ensure that our cities promote shared prosperity, climate justice, and racial justice. We do this in coalition with community groups, labor unions, environmental justice organizations, and faith networks. I'm going to start with two concepts that are really core to lots of different things that we do. The first one is the idea of community benefits. So community benefits are assets that are created or made available through economic development that meet real community needs. So our vision for development starts with community engagement, asking communities, what are our priorities? What do we really need right now? And that could be a lot of things. That could be greater access to transportation, addressing housing needs, getting more good jobs, or getting better access to those good jobs that exist or will be created, creating opportunities for small businesses. So it can look like a lot of different things. And then we move from community engagement to organizing and coalition building to develop policies that attach accountability to public spending and deliver those real benefits in concrete ways. The other concept that I want to talk about is really like, what do we mean when we talk about procurement? So cities wear a lot of different hats. They're regulators and enforcers. So an example of an economic policy that a city advances as a regulator would be like the adoption of a minimum wage law, which a lot of cities have done in recent years, right? Or paid sick leave. Those are things they do as regulators. But cities are also developers. They build and maintain infrastructure in our cities. They build parks. They also build major transportation and commerce hubs like ports, airports, entertainment centers like arenas and other tourist attractions. And they facilitate private development through a whole host of incentives for companies like cheap land, tax breaks, and so on. They are also purchasers of goods and services. And so this can be in their capacity as developers, meaning literally buying bricks or other equipment or hiring workers to do work to build things. But it can also mean hiring people in order to fulfill a governance goal. Like say you want to transform your transportation system, but you need some extra expertise. You might purchase that through hiring consultants, for example. So procurement is powerful because not all of these roles give cities equal latitude. As regulators, cities can be limited by state and federal law in terms of what they can do. For example, a lot of cities cannot adopt their own minimum wage or living wage policies for workers in their jurisdiction because state law prohibits it. But as the purchaser of a good or service and as a developer, cities have a lot of latitude for how, for setting standards for how they want the services or goods that they're purchasing to be created, for what kind of environmental standards they need to reach. And so that's one element that makes procurement a powerful way for cities to engage. And then the other is, as Satya was saying, money. In 2014, local government at the city and county level spent $1.6 trillion. And private companies want that money and are willing to meet higher standards in order to get access to it. So now I'm going to talk about a couple of, well, more than a couple, some strategies for procurement. And we can talk more about these in detail because I really want to spend my time on some examples. But some strategies for procurement advancing equity that we see in construction are things like project labor agreements, which are legally binding agreements between building trade unions and developers for a certain set of standards. They typically require a labor peace, which means no strikes, no lockouts, that can actually have a lot of positive effects in terms of delivering projects on time and under budget because you avoid disruption. There are also community workforce agreements, which are like project labor agreements, but they would include additional provisions like targeted hiring. And targeted hiring, which is also listed here as a separate strategy because it doesn't have to be part of a PLA, is when you reserve a certain number of jobs that are going to be created, for example, through the construction of a new museum or a new train line for workers from the community who, as many, you know, targeted hire standards are set in LA, based on what the unemployment rate in that zip code is. So workers who live in a certain zip code in LA where unemployment rates are higher than the state average get a certain number of the jobs are reserved for them. There are also other kinds of job quality standards like prevailing wage or apprenticeship utilization requirements, which require employers on construction projects to employ a certain number of apprentice-level workers. And this, the idea behind this is that it's requiring developers and construction companies to facilitate a pipeline for workers to get access to good jobs. And then in terms of community development, we have community benefit agreements, which are agreements between a community coalition and a developer. Sometimes the city government is also party to those agreements that can provide for a range of community benefits, and those can include some of the things I just talked about, but can also include things like investment in transit or housing or other types of community, meeting other types of community needs. There's also city agency policy governing subsidies, meaning, so for example, in the County of Los Angeles, the transit authority has a construction careers policy, which takes a bunch of the elements I just talked about and applies them to any project that meets a certain, that costs a certain amount of money to do. And so that, it has like a very complex but effective pipeline to get workers from those targeted zip codes into apprenticeship programs and onto jobs and through enough jobs that they get through apprenticeship and into union membership and then have the long-term benefits through the MTA's development. And then targeted and first source hire, I talked about a little bit, and can also be applied to economic development projects like public-private developments that cities do. And there are a number of sectors where these really can come into play, where there's a lot of public-private partnership and cities have a lot of investment. So I mentioned a couple of them earlier: airports, maritime ports, utilities, waste and recycling, transit, and hospitality. And hospitality is kind of a surprising one because it's not necessarily that cities are building hotels, but obviously there's a land use element of it, which is that cities hotel developers need to get permissions to do the kinds of things they want to do. But there's another element that cities have used, which is to talk about how tourism is a major aspect of the local economy. And so the city needs to ensure that there's a certain level of standards met in that particular sector. So I think there's ways to be creative too when you think about where does the city have an interest economically. So now I want to talk about two case studies that are two different strategies for using procurement to advance equity in cities. The first one is the Oakland Army Base Community Jobs Agreement. So the Oakland Army Base is a massive 300-acre site that was being redeveloped, and it was a big opportunity to create a lot of jobs. And so the purpose of the redevelopment is for the site to become a trade and logistics center for the Port of Oakland. The project is $1 billion, half of it is public money. And so very early in the process, a coalition of community organizations led by our affiliate eBase organized and were active in the land use planning process to insert some of the things I was just talking about into the request for proposals that were going out to developers. And so these included things like local hire, job quality, small business utilization. And so that happened very early on in the process. And then there was another goal that that emerged through the community process of making sure that these jobs, that these whoever the developers and the contractors that they hired banned the box, that they didn't consider or they didn't eliminate people's opportunities to work based on having a past criminal record. And so overall, there were 300 new jobs created. There was an agreement that 50% of those jobs would be local hire. They've actually exceeded that goal, that 25% would be disadvantaged workers, that 20% would be apprentices, that they adopted a ban the box policy, and they put restrictions on temp work, which is really important, that the site is gonna be largely warehouses that serve the port. And so when you think about long-term, the jobs that get created in those warehouses, the warehouse industry is dominated by very unsafe, temporary, precarious work. And so part of the goal of the community jobs agreement is not just to create pipelines towards construction careers through the development process itself, but to look forward into how that space is gonna be used in an ongoing way. So there was a multi-year campaign, and it involved an inside and an outsider strategy. And it was essential to work really closely with both the mayor and the city manager to negotiate the agreement. A city council person took leadership in terms of convening an ongoing set of stakeholders to figure out what the priorities were and actually do that negotiation process. And now there are two concrete mechanisms for enforcement, which is always going to be kind of the kicker. Well, for anything you win ever, probably, but certainly for community benefits. There's a jobs resource center in West Oakland that connects community members to the jobs that are being created at the Army base. And there's a community oversight board with stakeholders that are appointed by the mayor and by the city council with designated seats for members of that community coalition that organized around this set of goals. And so they're about 2 years into the process. It's interesting, there's sort of ongoing negotiations. The coalition has been so effective that they can go back and sort of try to extend some of the elements of the agreement and win more and sort of refine things because it's worked really well. At this point, Oakland workers have taken home 73% of the earnings on the project. So that's a community benefits model. And now I'm gonna talk a little bit about a pretty different model around our campaigns around reforming waste and recycling in some of the cities where we work. So waste and recycling is an example of a core city function where there are broad impacts on workers and the community. And where the city can use procurement as a powerful tool to raise standards and improve outcomes. But as you'll hear in this example, that wasn't the place we started from. So environmental justice organizations and mainstream environmental organizations have been really successful in moving government leaders, including mayors and city councils, to adopt ambitious recycling policies. But in many cities, there's not really a map for how you're gonna get to those goals. And so this was the case in Los Angeles. And so I'll come back to that in a second. I want to talk for a minute what the waste industry looks like for workers. It's riding on the back of a truck every day and hoisting heavy bins of who knows what into the truck. Or it can be hand sorting through trash that's coming through in order to be able to divert some of it to recycling. If you're in the public sector, these can be good jobs. If they're union jobs, they can be sustaining and provide a path to the middle class. But for many people, they are low-paid and very dangerous jobs. They're consistently the fifth most dangerous job, according to OSHA, and they pay between $10 and $15 an hour. They're often dominated by temps, so there's no job security, and really hard to hold your employer accountable if your conditions aren't safe. From an environmental justice perspective, it isn't just essential to increase recycling levels, although it is that also, but there's also pollution impact from the trucks in our neighborhoods. And so what was happening in LA and is also happening in New York is that the public sector picks up trash from individual homes. But then when it comes to apartment complexes and businesses, they license trash haulers, but everyone picks their own waste hauler. And so what this means is that in what was happening in LA, it ultimately got kind of termed the Wild West, because lots of different waste haulers would be crisscrossing each other in the same neighborhoods, picking up trash from their own customers, but not their customer's neighbor that a different waste hauler came to get. And so it was having all this impact on the city's infrastructure, but also producing all this additional pollution. And so, then the other piece of it is that in terms of environmental goals the city might have, there were dozens of trash haulers. The city had no capacity or framework for understanding how they were processing that waste, how much of it was really getting recycled, and all of those sorts of things, or intervening in the low job quality standards that workers faced. And so cities have been able to get a much better result by shifting to a procurement model via a franchise system. So under this model, the city designates zones in the city and then puts out an RFP for the right to pick up the commercial waste in those zones. And the city of LA adopted this model, and as part of the RFP included really stringent environmental, community impact, customer service, and worker standards. So there were a bunch of customer positive benefits of this, which is that rates became transparent, whereas previously there would be like 90 waste haulers and you would pick one and you had no idea if what you were paying was the market rate, and they actually were finding that the same companies were charging customers in the same neighborhoods wildly different amounts of money. And so we were able to organize local businesses also to support this, to sort of rationalize the system. So haulers compete to win the RFP, and then what the city has is they have a reasonable number of waste haulers that are operating that they can actually be in communication with about the environmental standards and the workplace standards. And because they're purchasing the service, they can set those standards, and they can set the standards for the workforce in particular. The success of the effort in LA, LA has adopted this franchise system, and it's been implemented, and that's inspired our New York affiliate, Alliance for Greater New York, to undertake a similar campaign there with labor partners and other environmental justice groups. And they are headed into official city council deliberations this year. And community members in the city of Long Beach, which is adjacent to Los Angeles, approached Lane, which is the affiliate we have there that we partnered with on this, for help winning a franchise model in that city. And the city of San Diego is also now looking at LA, so you can kind of see how once you show it's possible and you set a pathway for how cities can reach some of these really bold goals they've set out around environmental issues, that others will follow. I want to just run through what I think are a couple of tips and best practices, some of which feel like common sense, but as I was talking to some of my colleagues about this presentation, were the things they felt were most important. One is identifying a strong point of entry. If you haven't used a procurement model before, it's like, where do you start? Cities are spending money all day, every day on lots and lots of things. And I think one way that you pick is that you look at the city's priorities. So if you look at LA, there was this strong environmental goal that had been set out, and city leadership who really saw that as their legacy. And so finding a way to advance their legacy while achieving our goals as a community was a winning point of entry to move the city from doing just its job as a regulator to taking a procurement perspective. And then I think that when in terms of infrastructure or development, the first job, the first development in LA that used the construction careers model was the Echo Park Lake, which is an iconic LA place that everyone loves. It's a park. It's in a community where people are being displaced because of gentrification. And so there was it sort of brought together all of these elements around trying to hold the city accountable that building in our city is for all of us. So I think that those are some of the things that can help you identify, like, what is a good project to start with. I think also mapping out the procurement angle, as I was talking about a little bit earlier, you're going to have to work with allies and maybe bring in technical expertise in terms of the sort of legal framework in your city to figure out how you could move your city from operating as a regulator to operating from a procurement perspective, if that's part of what you need to do to achieve your goal. And then I think also obviously identifying the power that you need to move it. In LA, as I said, that meant organizing small businesses around how they wanted a more rational trash system that would actually result in more recycling. And that was really effective in helping moving city council, who were like, oh, is this just like a labor thing or just like an environmental thing, but it really became a broad coalition. Build relationships with staff early. I was in a different meeting this morning where they also said this, so it's probably not news to anyone, but I think worth underlining that if there's a perception from city staff that you want to create more work for them without additional resources, that you think you know more about the industry that they work in every single day when they know every player's name and they know how long they've been doing XYZ and they, you know, and they have all of this expertise, if you act like you don't need that or that you already have that, that's going to be a problem. So I think a coworker of mine said that at certain points, it can feel like trying to build coalition with someone who doesn't really necessarily want to be in a coalition with you, but that you can get there if you start early and you tap into their expertise and also educate them about how you think your goals are achievable. They can be really amazing allies and really help and collaborate in figuring out how to move things. And then finally, planning for implementation, including funding. This is related to the staff issue because folks are pressed in terms of resources, so it's really important to plan how staff will be able to actually implement the requirements that you're winning. So part of this is being realistic and funding the implementation and enforcement. In the case of the Los Angeles trash hauling reform, the companies share revenues back with the city. So they win the right to operate in a certain zone, and then there's a percentage revenue share that goes back to the city that funds the inspection of their processing sites and kind of keeps the whole system going. So in terms of additional resources, these are some publications that are on our website that go into more detail and offer more examples. Over the last decade, we have developed a lot of expertise from both a legal and strategic angle on this, and now like to kind of be a hub and a resource for other movement partners. So you should feel free to reach out and strategize with us. And with that, I'm going to step aside.
Good afternoon, everyone. As Satya mentioned, my name is Jesse Kingston. I'm the director for the Department of Human Rights and Equal Economic Opportunity in the City of St. Paul. This is a department that is pretty unusual and one of the few of its kind in the United States. It's one also that I recommend highly for a lot of jurisdictions when you are looking at how do you bring together procurement and leverage strategies and make changes in your community. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that. But I first want to kind of mention that it really does start at the top, and we've been really fortunate to have a mayor that has been championing addressing racial inequities and creating wealth, starting not only as a mayor, he's in his third term, but actually beginning back when he was on the city council. And what started back in 2004 that led through to 2008 was a series of audits that the city had completed. A lot of the information, just so you are aware, that I'm going to show you and laws and some of those things are all available on our website at stpaul.gov/HREEO. So don't worry about trying to capture all of this information. I know some of you are taking some quick notes. But we really did, from 2004 to 2008, take a look at how are we as a city spending money, not only as a city, but also our housing and redevelopment authority and our planning and economic development. And what we did find, which a lot of cities I think do uncover when they do these disparity studies, is that there is a lack of accountability, communication, and resources, and that our small women and minority-owned businesses are actually not getting the opportunity that they need. And the really incredible thing about the disparity study, and we are actually embarking on our latest disparity study, is it does involve the community. It is not an insulated look, but it gets feedback as well from the community, and that's really important to have that throughout. When we went through a number of these disparity studies in 2008, our city attorney looked at a lot of the recommendations and engaged the community in ways to address it. And one of the biggest things that came out of it was the creation of the department that I lead, which is Human Rights and Equal Economic Opportunity, that brings together our civil rights investigation group, our capacity building and workforce development, our contract monitoring, investigation, and enforcement arm, and our contract analysis and procurement group, which also includes a print shop. This is pretty unusual to have these groups under one department head and working together and making sure that the things that we do are actually happening. And what we were finding is when these were separated into multiple departments, we had a disconnect. We were not communicating and we were not leveraging what we needed to do. And so one of the things that is really important to note is we've got a lot of ordinances that govern who we are and give us authority to do the things that we need to do. And that's, if you see the very first one up there, is the formation of that department. And what we found is, you know, if we're going to do this, we have to make sure that we make this very concrete. And so in the ordinance, you'll see a whole process around how the department head is actually appointed through a community process. You'll see information about how affirmative action, as well as our vendor outreach program, all of that intertwines. And it's really great to be able to say, this is how we're doing it, and this is why we're doing it, and this is how we're governed. Because without that, it makes it a challenge to make change. And so some of the things I'm going to talk about, local equity and inclusion. We have a vendor outreach program, and we'll talk about some of the results that it has. But this is our inclusion of our small businesses. When we talk about our vendor outreach program, it's a small business inclusion program. It's something that our disparity study looks at. And within this group of businesses that have been certified, we actually certify businesses as well as women or minority owned. This is a collaborative that we had called a CERT collaborative, which includes both Ramsey and Hennepin County, two of our largest counties in the state of Minnesota. And it's a really huge outreach that impacts a lot of different businesses. We also have our affirmative action, which any vendor that has a $50,000 spend, whether that be a one-time spend or spend over 12 months, actually has to have an affirmative action plan. And we also have goals on a number of projects, over 50,000, in which there are workforce goals. And we'll go into what those look like as well. The latest numbers require 32% minority workforce and 6% female. We also have a living wage ordinance. We've got prevailing wage on local construction and living wage on contracts over 100,000. And then Section 3, although a lot of jurisdictions, when you're receiving the HUD funding, have this requirement, we actually have Section 3, and we do preferences for bidding of 10% of Section 3 for low-income businesses, both employees as well as the vendors. So how do we go about doing this? From a procurement perspective, one of the things that we looked at is how do we make change and be effective? We had the disparity study and all these other audits that tell us we needed to make change. And so over the last few years when this department was formed in 2009, we've really been drilling into how to do that. The first thing that we did was we rolled out a brand new supplier portal through our ERP system. It's something that is highly used in a lot of jurisdictions as well as in the private sector. This is a no-fee portal. Anyone can go out there and register and take a look at it. all the plans, all the specs, same day registration, all of that is available to a vendor. It makes it easier to find out what we are actually doing. And you have the option as a vendor to go in there and register by a specific commodity code so that when we release a bid package, you will be notified instantaneously via email so that you know that we are looking for your input and to have you bid on our projects. The next thing that we did is we looked at the long-term contracts that we had, and we went through and reduced a number of them. We had quite a few contracts that we had that were over 5 years long, and the same vendor was still getting the contract, and we weren't letting other opportunities come in. And when we have a lot of vendors out there who are wanting to do business with the city, we need to make sure that that opportunity is available to them. So unless there is something really urgent that needs to be looked at and taken care of once you hit 5 years, we are going to actually go out and make sure that we bid out that contract. The next thing that we've done is we've revamped a lot of our contract language. We've also been employing plain language from the administration, from the president, not only in contract but in our compliance and enforcement arm as well to make it easier. We've also been looking at, do we need to be making other changes? And I'll talk about change that we've made, but that's been really critical for everyone. The next has been our bonding threshold. We did recently an audit. We have a summer intern program called Right Track for the city. We have a number of interns as well as partnerships with local universities and colleges, and we have legal interns who came in and took a look to see whether or not our bonding thresholds caused a negative impact on some of our vendors. And we actually were out of sync with what the state recommended, and we increased our bond threshold so that our businesses, particularly our SWIMBs, had a greater opportunity and had less of a negative impact in order to be able to do business with the city. So some of our new initiatives is our set-aside program. So I mentioned that we have our CERT program for our certified vendors. We used to have, beginning with Penny One, that if you were doing business with the city, you had to have a plan about inclusion on our certified businesses. And for some of the purchases that we made, that didn't make sense. And so we wanted to make a change, but we didn't want to lose sight of the fact that our businesses could lose opportunities. So we created a set-aside program that under $50,000, and actually in some cases it's up to $100,000, we will give our SWIMB vendors a first opportunity, and as long as they are within 5% of the lowest bid, we are going to be encouraging the city to actually drive the business to them. And these are things that we do not have to go out on a sealed bid for, and it's been a really great opportunity for those businesses. The other thing is we include in our RFPs is our social equity and vendor outreach program, so that any business that is wanting to do business with the city of St. Paul, they know right away what you actually have to do, what our business inclusion plan is, what our affirmative action plans are. They know it up front, and they are required to put in their bid package how they're going to meet that in the project so that we don't lose sight of that. And then by having our contract compliance and enforcement group in our department, they are there when we are doing our pre-bids, when we're talking to vendors, they're on site, they're answering questions. So the businesses don't have an excuse to say, I didn't know about this. And then once a contract is signed, they're there monitoring those projects and making sure that they're meeting not only the business inclusion goals, but making good faith efforts to achieve or exceed the workforce goals as well. We also have authority through the state to do best value procurement. It's something that we haven't looked at before, and we are now working with another jurisdiction and learning how they do it, and have done, I believe, one best value procurement bid so far. And this allows us on things where we don't have to have a sealed bid, meaning we have to go with the lowest price, to be able to have different criteria on our bids, not just price, and we can include points around our social inclusion and our vendor outreach. And looking at past performance and scoring them on that is a way to measure whether or not they'll be successful. because we value and make sure that we want our small businesses and our workforce to be reflective of the community that we work in. And so those are some of the new changes that we've made. The other thing that we do is a fair amount of outreach. And one of the things that we have done, we have held for the first time in 2015 a procurement fair. And this is the first time that we brought city departments out, and they actually, over 2 days in 2015, we presented some of our key projects that were coming about. And we brought together our prime and our subcontractors together to come and learn about it, to talk to departments, to understand what their needs were, as well as understand and ask any questions about the goals. The other thing is we had our procurement staff there registering vendors to be on the supplier portal so that when these projects came out, they actually knew about it. So we're now in a situation where if someone says, I don't know how or to be involved or how to get notified, we can direct them to the supplier portal. We've also been leveraging our relationships with our libraries, and we have about once a month times where businesses can actually go in now and register on the supplier portal. We have a number of relationships with other organizations within the city. We have what's called a construction partnership program. We call it speed dating for businesses, and we really bring together our primes and our contractors together so that they can meet and hopefully build relationships as they are putting together their plans to meet our goals. That outreach has been really critical. So to give you guys some idea of what this change has meant, from an affirmative action perspective, when we look at our hiring goals, and these are the workforce goals that we are required on our projects. They changed originally a minority of 11%. Our state commissioner changed that to 32% just before I started with the city of St. Paul. We were at 15.95% for our goals, and in 2015, we're up at 22%. Which has been a huge jump to be moving that over the time, as well as for female workers from 4.8%, we are actually achieving that 6% goal on our projects. And this has been a really big thing. As part of the outreach, we've had to work with other organizations as well to help us with developing programs. When you saw one of the things that we do in terms of workforce development, we actually support organizations with some small funding that we have available to our department that helps train people in how to do specific jobs. One example is we had an opportunity to partner with Goodwill Easter Seals, NDC, our Neighborhood Development Center, and another organization. Goodwill Easter Seals, we funded the program that was training our adult Section 3 residents in how to do construction, and they turned around and in our Frogtown neighborhood, which has been one of our more low-income neighborhoods, they turned around and built more moderate income level housing. And this is one of the first times that we actually did that with partnership and funding and bidding out stuff and making sure that what we are doing in our community also helps, stays in our community, and develops things in our community. And that's things that we weren't necessarily doing before. And so we see those changes coming through. But most importantly, what I think is really critical for the success that we have, from our vendor outreach program, is that we, our agency of the three of the collaborative actually does the certification. We have over 1,500 vendors that are now certified as a SWMBE vendor. In 2008, when we had done one of the last studies had come out, we had less than 1% of our minority businesses getting a piece of the pie for what we were doing for our construction and HRA projects. And our women were getting just over 1%. That's not acceptable. And so we put together a lot of work, and in 2015, I am thrilled, and I apologize, I noticed that the goals are incorrect. For minority businesses, it actually is 5%, and we're at 5.89%. And while that percentage seems really small, and the disparity study will tell us what we should be doing for new goals, what I think is really important is if you look at in 2008, only $1.1 million going to minority-owned businesses to now being up at $35.5 million is a huge swing in over a few years. And when we look at what's been going on with our female businesses having 1% to having 15%, or going from $1.3 million to $95 million worth in revenue, is absolutely incredible. We haven't seen that before. And that's why I say bringing all of these different divisions under one department and being a collective has made a huge change. By making these changes and being really intentional about it, we've actually been very fortunate to have our purchasing manager actually, sorry, there's a fly up here, receive recently the Minnesota NGIP Procurement Manager of the Year Award. We've also received the U.S. Communities Award for the work that we've been doing with leveraging cooperative contracts. We've finally have been able to partner with Bloomberg Philanthropies' What Works City, and that has been looking at how do we further streamline and make changes within our primarily public works is where we've been focusing on. And the work that we've been doing and some of the changes that we've been making partnering with the departments has actually brought in more competition and better pricing for the city on our public works contracts. So we've seen some great changes on that. As I mentioned, partnership has been really key. The work that we've been doing and the outreach has been critical to be with a lot of these organizations. AWC is our Association of Women Contractors. They've been a great organization to work with. They head up our construction partnership program now. Everybody In, to name a few, MSDC, Twin Cities Rise. There aren't enough community organizations that jurisdictions can't work with to make these changes. And that's the important thing, is to make sure that that continues. And so with that, I know we're gonna go into some of our Q&A, but that's some of the changes that we've made in the city of St. Paul.
Can we just take the projector off, please? Thank you. Because that way you're not distracted.
One mic, and do we have a mic for the audience too? Yes?
Yes, great. So we'll just do, and we have to be on mic because they're streaming us, so they can't hear you in the virtual reality if you don't have a mic. So I have tons of questions, but you guys have been sitting for a while and you probably have thoughts and questions, so we'll start with you guys. Is it possible for one of you to run the mic down to folks? Right here in the flowered dress has a question. Or do you need one of ours? Okay.
Can you hear me?
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you for your presentations. I live in a small city with a relatively large budget deficit that's interested in getting an office like this off the ground. And so I'm wondering what advice you have to a city that wants to get started and what options there are for funding.
So we had a couple of different things. My understanding, because this department was formed just before I started, I'm the second director. They use grants, but they also use existing resources. They put different divisions together and formed a new department, so they weren't taking new resources out of the budget. And I think like a lot of cities, we are all running tight on resources. You're not the only one. So I would recommend looking at some grants as part of the startup, really sort of driving towards creating opportunities for your SWMB businesses as well as your residents.
The only thing I would add is that there's a lot of resources, there's a lot of sort of non-financial resources out of there that you can use for technical assistance, which is a bunch of the sort of startup cost, right? Is figuring out what's the best way to put it all together, and then what are the ordinances that you need, and then what are, you know, the sort of operating systems of it all. And so certainly the partnership is a great resource. We have some information at COWS and the Mayor's Innovation Project, but if I,
I didn't know that this was a What Works Cities topic, but if the Bloomberg What Works Cities group is looking at procurement, then that's another great resource. And obviously they have a lot of money. So can't hurt to go looking. But I definitely think that there's, you do need cash, no question, but there's also sort of technical assistance that's available. It's a great question, thank you. And Steve has a question next to you.
I'll make it easy. Steve Dubb with the Democracy Collaborative, and I'm forgetting the name now, for Partnership for Working Families, right? Yeah, so I was curious about hotels and hospitalities. You'd mentioned that. And I know in some cases, particularly convention center hotels, often they are actually city financed and technically city owned. So I was wondering if any of your affiliates have been working in that area in particular, and you know, what have been the areas of leverage in terms of, you know, creating local jobs and local procurement?
I think that is correct, in where there's a direct relationship. I think there are a few different ways to get at hotels. One is where there's a direct relationship because it's on city property or part of a public-private project, as a convention center would be. I think sometimes communities get engaged in the land use process as a way of making demands on hotels that are completely a private project. I think the city of LA is a really good example of sort of creative and expansive thinking about hospitality as an industry. And so 10 or 15 years ago, or maybe more than that, the city of LA passed a living wage ordinance for the airport because it is a economic center for the city, both as a way that people enter the city for tourism, but also where goods are delivered and shipped from, that included the hotels around the airport. And so that was one step. And then a couple of years ago, before the fight for 15 really took off and exploded, the city of LA had actually passed a hotel worker living wage in the city, just purely based on the premise that tourism is such an important part of the city economy, that having certain standards in the hotels was necessary in terms of turnover and training and stability. I think that there was a lot of organizing with hotel. There's a certain amount of union density in LA that facilitates that, and there was a lot of organizing with hotel owners to figure out how it could be connected to other goals that the industry had around, like, green retrofitting. So it's more complex, and I could connect you with the person who could tell you all of those details. But so I think yes, there are lots of ways, and that maybe one of the stories that LA tells is that you start where the connection is the most direct, and then you figure out how do you expand on that and build on that as the city is changing how it thinks about an industry.
Other questions for these two over here?
I'm curious what both cities do to combat and look out for fraud, both in the women-owned, minority-owned business category, in other words, sham, you know, non women-owned or minority-owned businesses that purport to be, and second, fraud with respect to procurement, the connection between procurement and contributions, political contributions. I'm from Chicago, so I deal with stuff.
It's a great question. Either of you want to start?
So, in terms of businesses, and a lot of times you'll hear them called as fronts, where they'll try and register as a woman-owned business, but really the husband is the one that is doing all of the work. So because we certify, we do a pretty in-depth certification process, application process. We look at stuff. We will go on site. We also don't do a certification that lasts for the life of the business. It gets looked at every 3 years. So every 3 years, they have to go through the same certification process. We do have reciprocity with some other organizations that do even more in-depth, are
North Central Minority Supplier Development Council. They have about, I think, 300 businesses, but they do a lot of work too. We also take complaints. Someone can give us a complaint and we will investigate it. And that is part of that contract compliance, because we don't want those businesses to be doing, getting in there and getting that work. That's not what we're about. So, and I would say since I've been there, we've gotten, I would say, that have risen to me less than five that have come as complaints. And some of them we've had to go through, and they've been contentious at times, and we have to talk about when we say this is what it means to actually be a certified business. So I have a team of people that are actually dedicated to certifying and working on all of that with the businesses.
I'm going to speak at all to the, who makes the decisions on the contracts?
So on the contracts, again, there are a couple different things. So there's state law that talks about sealed bids over $100,000. So it is the lowest price, but it goes to the responsible, responsive bidder, which sounds like a mouthful at times, but there's actually a state or a law around it that they recently passed. And so there's a whole host of things that you have to meet in order to be eligible for that. We also have a debarment language. We have a debarment.
And when you say sealed bid.
Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you. So a sealed bid is the bids all come in, and then we have a public opening. So you don't see it until there's actually a public opening. Sorry. It's something I had to learn. When I came in from the private sector, it was very, very different for me. I was like, where's the confidentiality agreements? Where's this? We do what? And so that was a learning experience. So
I would just add on your second point, and now I'm drawing on my experience in 6 years on the Madison City Council, that it in many cities, I will not say most, but in many cities, there's a fairly elaborate process around the bidding, the opening of the bids, the awarding of the bids, and it's fairly regimented. Unfortunately, in most places, it's regimented towards the least amount of money, right? So spending the least amount of money, which doesn't always get you the best product or meet any of the other goals that you might have. But I think that a lot of that developed from exactly what you're talking about with, you know, the cousin getting the contract or whatever. And so, you know, certainly in Wisconsin and in other places as well, there's a sort of infrastructure that's built up around that. What I see the challenge as is to maintain that sense of transparency and a lot of the work around bidding, procurement, and contracts happen at the staff level rather than at the political or elected level, but still in a very transparent way that the public could find out what was going on if it wanted to. And then at the same time, being able to layer on goals around local businesses, getting the business or hiring local people or building local economies. And sometimes those two things are in tension. But I think that they're both really important goals, and so that's one of the things that we have to sort of live with and figure out. Do you want to add anything?
Yeah, I'll just add in terms of some practical thoughts about how community stakeholders can help with the transparency process, which is to understand how the bidding process works in your city. A lot of the times you can attend the conferences where the bids are announced. You can see who's there and who's interested, so you get a sense of what the field is. If you have relationships in the industry with folks who you see as responsible players or local businesses, that, you know, you can talk to them about what the process is like to really get educated on how it works, and that I think would help you see if something seemed irregular. And I think that mapping out, if you're particularly interested in a specific contract, mapping out in advance what the relationships are that might raise a flag like that, and to be prepared. I think that it's important to for the community to be prepared to make some of those things transparent if they're not going to happen that way on their own. And that even the appearance that you're going to do that can be an effective protection against some kind of improper allocation.
Not Chicago. Yeah, unfortunately, Chicago is its own beast in many ways. But I do think it's true that it speaks also to the need for strong campaign finance laws and strong ethics laws, and so this is not a sort of isolated thing. Are there other questions from folks in the audience over here?
I love this idea of the don't waste LA. I used to live over a commercial alleyway in Washington, D.C., and there were five or six garbage trucks that would go down it every day. I'm curious about, can you expand on what the labor component of that was, and how has it improved the contractors?
Sure. So some of the labor parts of the contract are pretty just like direct and straightforward, like paying the city living wage, which the city has the right to ask for if they're awarding a contract. But other elements have to do with how the work is actually done, where worker interests and environmental interests are actually quite aligned. For example, one of the things that makes some of the things that make waste hauling really dangerous have to do with understaffing or just poor systems for processing waste. So understaffing is going to have an effect where maybe you need two people to be hoisting bins into a truck, but you only have one because you're on a super low road, and you know, and that's how the industry is operating, and you're just trying to compete, and so that's what you're doing too. So that creates industry injury risk. But the other is that LA, in its like single home waste system, which was already a franchise system, was a three bin system of paper, plastic, trash. But in the commercial side, it was like, whatever you do, you just, you know, it's up to the hauler. And so there was a ton of work that was workers sorting waste. And that's where you get like needles pop up or broken glass or these things that folks aren't prepared for that create all these additional risks. So the new system requires a three bin system. Ultimately, it will also include composting. So there are ways that you can build worker protection into the environmental standards that that's been effective in LA.
That's really interesting. Other questions?
We have one here, and then we'll go over here.
Hello. Oakland is soon to adopt a preferential procurement ordinance for worker cooperatives, and it would be the first in the country. And I'm curious if either of your cities have considered giving preference to worker cooperatives specifically, given the high impact they have on community economic development.
Thank you for asking that. And let me expand it just a little bit, because it was almost exactly what I was going to ask. we're at a conference around the new economy. And so in addition to anything you want to comment on about worker co-ops, if you have anything around social enterprises or other types of sort of less traditional business structures, employee-owned, et cetera, that that help to build local economies in a sort of different way, that's interesting. And then also just the if either of you have anything to say about the sort of local economic impact of the work around both the worker standards and the who's getting the contracts. I think this all sort of speaks to the same questions around the new economy, right? That's a lot to hold, but maybe start with the co-ops, and we'll go over here.
Okay. In order for us to have goals on contracts, we have to be able to demonstrate that there is a disparity that occurs. And so our last disparity study didn't have that. We've got a new disparity study. The state is leading it. The contract with the state has been signed. We're in the process of getting our joint powers agreement executed. So if it comes through on the disparity study that there would be something for these types of businesses, then we would look at having goals. If we don't, if the research shows, we could very well be sued, and if we don't have a disparity study to back that up, we will lose on that. So that is the first thing for us that is really critical. But I will say that by having these goals, as you saw in some of the graphs, it makes a tremendous impact.
But having the goals themselves doesn't mean anything if you are not actively working on making change happen. And that is exactly what we had found. We had goals, right? But we had audits that were done that were showing why we weren't achieving those goals. And so it's really important to have the relationships internally with multiple departments, with the community, to have also oversight. We have a commission that holds up to 21 members that provides guidance and oversight of our department that looks at this. We have our numbers all published. We're held accountable by the community, and people want to see change, and we are making change. And oftentimes we're looked at as best practices for the changes that we've made in a short amount of time. But it really does take a large group to move that forward, and that's really important.
Maybe the way to ask the second part of my question is, what do you think the overlap is between the businesses that you're targeting and businesses that are local to St. Paul or the Twin Cities, and maybe in your case, businesses that might be in the co-op economy or have a B Corp or a different structure? You think there's any overlap there?
When you say overlap.
How many of your women-owned businesses are located in St. Paul versus being somewhere else?
I don't know the number off the top of my head because we certify in, I think, 7 to 15 counties. Okay. Because we have both the city of St. Paul, Hennepin, and Ramsey County. So there are a number of businesses that are not necessarily going to be in the city of St. Paul. I will say that unlike some of the corporate businesses that are there, you see, corporate could be some of our prime construction businesses, if you think about construction, that we find our SWMB vendors, again, our small women minority business enterprises, tend to hire more people of color and more women than our prime businesses, as well as the private sector, and hence the reason why we have our affirmative action program, but we do see greater numbers coming out of them.
Thank you. So there, I do know of an example, and it's a super new thing for us, where there's, and I'm not going to say where it's happening because I'm pretty sure this is not a public discussion there, and I don't want to blow up their spot, but there's a redevelopment project in our network where there's a local discussion happening about whether the concessions there should be a co-op. In part because the local community surrounding there has a large number of folks who are undocumented, and there's a thought that would be a better approach for that community. Historically, when we look at development projects, we have a really strong emphasis on union jobs. And so I think it's new for us to think about other formations of worker power, and that's something that we're really entering. I think from a worker perspective, particularly like my role as a partnership is to focus on how over the last 40 years, employment has become increasingly non-standard, meaning workers are contracted out, misclassified as independent contractors, required to operate as temps, forced into very unpredictable part-time schedules, et cetera, et cetera. And that we may need to organize ourselves in other ways going forward. So I think, part of why I'm here is to learn more about co-ops and other formations that could, but I think there's a lot of work to do to bridge this other center of worker power, which is the labor movement, to the conversations that are happening more in these spaces, and to figure out how those are connected. Because I think, to be totally frank, in the world I operate in, there's a lot of skepticism, which might have to do with unfamiliarity, but skepticism about scalability, about whether it really confronts power, about how sustainable it is, et cetera. So I would say it's entering our consciousness slowly and coming up organically in some of the communities where we work, but there's a lot more to think about.
And I'm sure you know about the work in Richmond, California, but the only thing I would add is that Madison, Wisconsin doesn't have a preference. I'm not entirely sure that they would think it was legal either. But we do have a significant amount of money that the city has dedicated over the next 5 years towards building the cooperative economy in Madison. And that looks like training, it looks like helping businesses transition to cooperatives if they want to. And that contract is a contract just now being let or maybe was voted on last week. So that project is just getting started, and it's something that if you're interested in the ways that local government can support the cooperative movement, the cooperative economy, I would watch Oakland, I would watch Richmond, California, and I would watch Madison, Wisconsin, for sure, among others.
I will add one more thing.
So just to add one more thing, I think it would be another place that might be of interest is Montgomery County, Maryland, where the county was going to try to regulate the introduction of companies like Uber and Lyft into the market, and the state preempted them, so they couldn't do it. But what they did do as a local government is begin to facilitate the formation of a cab co-op in Montgomery County that would give the drivers that were already there the capacity to compete with some of these national operators that are coming in, as well as access to technology to reach passengers. So
that's really interesting. Great. All right, you get the last question.
All right, the last one. So actually, this may be more the original origin story for the St. Paul kind of example. I was trying to get a sense of what the driving energy was to make that movement happen, and assuming it's coming from outside the government, and also so that ongoing relationship, it seems like the folks who helped drive this maybe initially are part of that commission, that's part of the kind of the teeth to make sure that they're staying on path around the metrics being set up. Could you tell us more about that?
So there was a lot of community input that they weren't getting business, they weren't getting job and opportunities on the community on the city contracts. I will admit, because I was not there, I can't tell you what organizations were involved in that, but I will say that we are certainly held accountable by the community. There are a number of organizations. They come in, we talk to them, they talk to the mayor, they look at our website, and they hold us accountable. Our commission was originally aligned only with our human rights department at the time, and we expanded their role under the formation of this department. Some of those members may actually have been part of community input that was done. The city attorney at the time held 3 community listening sessions and had input from the community about what the issues were and what people wanted to see, and he made the recommendations back to the mayor around that. When a department director gets reappointed, and this just recently happened, I'm on my second term now, they actually do a community evaluation. So they sent out surveys, they had a public hearing, and they solicited input from multiple people on whether or not we were actually being effective. And so there is that constant turn of, are we doing what we set out to do? And if we're not, why aren't we? And we'll be held accountable. So our commissioners can rotate on and off. So again, they may have been part of it, but they certainly are there to make sure that we're doing what we're supposed to be doing.
Thank you very much. Thank you all very much for coming. We have to wrap up now, but let's thank Mariah and Jesse one more time for being here.
Thank you.
And the next thing is right here in only a matter of minutes, so don't go too far away.